We are, I think. That was one hell of a cosplay show.
Yep.
I don't think they've decided who got first, second, or third.
Well, you're top three, Lumi.
Crystal Maiden is definitely in top three.
Yep.
Did not have a puppy, though.
But yeah, it was still the Arcana, though.
Oh, yeah.
First time seeing
Arcana. There was a cat in the stadium. Yeah. Could have actually just...
Or maybe she was in fog so that you don't see the pet when you're in fog.
That's true.
It was, full immersion.
The meatballs from yesterday weren't here.
Oh, they're not on. If the meatballs were on, they're taking first, second, third, and fourth.
Yeah.
I thought the Wind Ranger was pretty good.
Yeah, me too.
No arrow, though. Got to dock a couple points.
I was not so
impressed.
Wind Ranger, yeah.
Okay. You like the one with the wings.
Yeah, the one on the left of the wings. It wasn't actually a Dota character, I don't think.
No,
It looked good.
That's Skywrath Mage.
I like the Night Stalker, too. I had the Night Stalker.
Literally not the Night Stalker, but okay.
Was the Night Stalker the one beside that?
The blue one, the wolf, yeah. I mean, the Night Stalker, not the wolf. Sorry. Correction.
I thought the Zelda cosplay was all right.
Yes.
Yeah. We are going to throw it to the casters now.
Why?
I think.
Oh.
Production just streaming casters. Game's happening. Game 3 of Empire versus 4CL.
To a break, you mean?
To the casters. Here we go.
I guess they were up there the whole time, the players. All right, new series. Best of three.
Maybe. Is it over to casters yet? All right.
Are we not doing draft?
Nope.
They just stripped our privilege.
We're going to be joined by Grandis V. What the hell is going on with this lobby? Paused still. So, guess the draft is going to be kind of going eventually. But, dude, what are your thoughts so far?
Man, both of these games have had a lot of very cool plays. How often do you get to see full Roshan steals, let alone back-to-back? First game, four Clovers were able to pull theirs off. Second game, it was for Team Empire. Both pretty darn amazing. And, those big team fights should be really fun to watch. Moving on inside this series, as there has been a lot of overextensions and then very good punishes from both of the teams. A lot of the props go to the supports. In the first game, we saw Saxon, his Vengeful Spirit absolutely rock the show. And then game number two, Empire, with their Winter Wyvern, getting a full Refresher Orb and Blink Dagger. That double Winter's Curse was backbreaking.
I don't know exactly what time they got that, but it was a lot faster than you would expect on a Winter Wyvern, that's for sure. I don't really know if you have to alter your bans that much. Like, the Bane, the Doom, the Io, I feel like those are three you have to take out. Maybe you let the Bane in, unless you have some sort of significant strategy lined up either of these two sides. But I don't know. I feel like definitely taking the Shadow Fiend or getting rid of it is going to be in Empire's best interest. But no, it's actually going to be a Gyrocopter to get the boot out. So it seems like there may be some draft trades going on right now. Io, Shadow Fiend, Darkseer, these are the heroes that are going to be involved in said trade.
They're going to be giving up one of either the Shadow Fiend or the Darkseer here, I'd expect. Probably the SF for Four Clovers. Whenever it's available, they pick it up for Pycat, and they will do just that here. We saw in game number one how potent Pycat is on this hero, especially when you have the supports to back him up. Pycat is an absolute monster.
And we'll see what supports Four Clovers want to grab, but this is pretty much a good start. It's, at least for Four Clovers, one of the safest starts that they can find. Empire, though, going to grab the Tusk, going to grab the Winter Wyvern one more time. We have seen not that much Winter Wyvern. In the in Vilnius, we saw zero Winter Wyverns. The other day, we saw one, and it lost. But now it seems like Empire are kind of remembering that this hero is actually really sick. And after last game, I think that was kind of an outlier. Usually we don't see Winter Wyverns directly participate for a mid lane first blood, then get, I think she got a double kill by going up towards the top lane, if I recall correctly. That's usually not what happens with Winter Wyvern. Usually the game isn't that fast. But if you are on the Winter Wyvern, man, just give it to Aloha Dance one more time, and you're going to be golden. Whereas Four Clovers, this is Four Clovers through and through. This is what we've seen from them time and time again from this tournament. Pycat's Shadow Fiend should be Niqua's Darkseer, although Bambo did it pretty well last game.
Yeah, even though Bambo did well on the Darkseer, I think Niqua has been looking a little bit better relative to his other heroes on the DS. And I think just having that comfort pick is going to be very useful for 4CNL here, as they themselves, again, are going to ban out the Viper, a pretty difficult lane, just annoying hero that they don't want to have to manage. Right now, Team Empire's opening is incredibly open-ended. Tusk and Winter Wyvern can pretty much do it all. Good in teamfights, good in pickoff scenarios. Very flexible when it comes to where you can put them laning-wise.
Maybe like another Queen of Pain or something like that for resolution, keep themselves a little bit more open-ended. Decent matchup versus the Shadow Fiend. You could do the exact same thing as they did in the last game. Versus the Viper, much tougher target to gank. There it is.
Yeah.
You know, maybe you're going to be patient and wait for that Shadow Fiend, maybe not, but either way, Winter Wyvern with the Queen of Pain's help, Shadow Fiend with currently no one's help, maybe a Dazzle's help. That might be the pick here for Four Clovers, or pick down the line at any rate. I would expect that to be the mid lane matchup for this game.
Yeah, or maybe even EGM on an Ancient Apparition could offer a little bit of poking, but instead it's going to be a Shaker. Yeah, very interesting for Four Clovers. This is a hero that is very team-dependent. Okay. Like, we don't see it very often.
I mean, third game, this is an even series so far, so I guess this is... I mean, I guess it's like game one and game three are the ones that you want to experiment with, since essentially this is another game one. We haven't seen Earthshaker a hell of a lot, and now it's Team Empire just going to go ahead and grab an Anti-Mage. I don't think the environment this time for Anti-Mage is as good as it was in Four Clovers versus Vega, where Vega really just didn't have any answers to an Anti-Mage who was bouncing all over the place. And of course, that Anti-Mage had a Magnus. It's not impossible to see a Magnus here from Team Empire, and in fact, it might be banned out, but for the Anti-Mage, there's a Darkseer wall, which is a pain in the ass for sure, and you're going into an Earthshaker, so there is a lot of threat to be had here, and I expect there to be a little bit more in the way of crowd control from Four Clover's last pick, but Empire, they are going to have a lot of scaling late game damage. Some of the most that we've seen from these tournaments have come from the Anti-Mage.
Interesting ban on the Ancient Apparition. Do you think that's just to protect the Darkseer and the Dazzle's healing, or is there something else in mind?
And there's not really many heroes that are like very frequently picked up that almost rely exclusively on healing. Like, I mean that are left in the pool that haven't been picked already. Huskar would have been one, but that was already banned out. Ancient Apparition would have given Empire enough power to fight in lane. If you look at Four Clover's draft right now, they have solid laners, but they're really kind of more on the passive side. They're not super aggressive. Earthshaker can get occasionally some blocks off, but Dazzle really never wants to be super offensive. Shadow Fiend just wants to get his souls up, wants to get his items, Sanjinyasha, Shadow Blade, what have you. And Darkseer just wants his mech, so that will allow Empire to be assertive. And I think that whoever can be more aggressive, more assertive in the early game phase is usually going to have, I don't want to say the game, but most of the game.
And right now it kind of feels like Empire have better tools at doing that. They're a lot less dependent on getting items up on their heroes. Just getting the experience up for the Tuscan Queen of Pain is enough to where you can find pickoffs. And once you have Winter's Curse, huge leap in power. Whereas for Four Clovers, don't take anything away from Echo Slam and Weave. It's just not nearly as flashy and not nearly as easy to translate that into direct teamfight victories until you have like a Blink Dagger to back that up, which isn't going to be coming until much later down the line, as I'd expect this Earthshaker is probably a support. Although it is not impossible that's a Niqua Darkseer and a Bamboo Shaker. What are your thoughts on that?
Yeah, I mean, that'll be fine as well. I'm usually not a huge fan on an offlane Shaker, especially when you're going up against an Anti-Mage. I feel like it was possible until the Anti-Mage was picked up, and the Anti-Mage was picked up directly afterwards. The matchup there is just already bad for the Earthshaker, like going into the offlane. No matter what, your matchups are going to be pretty sour. But now you're going up against someone who can blink on you, destroy your mana pool, and you really, as a Shaker, don't have mana to spare, and can actually solo kill you. Like, the Anti-Mage doesn't need that much help, but if he gets help from either a Snowball or a Burn from the Winter Wyvern, it's a very easy kill. I think that's probably not going to be happening from the Four Clover side. There's no reason to do that over sending Darkseer down there.
It really feels like, well, now Rubick pick for Team Empire. I don't think that changes what I was about to say, that this Anti-Mage is going to have a good time when it comes to the laning stage. Four Clovers, Darkseer isn't going to put enough pressure onto the AM by himself, and I don't think there's going to be another one of those aggressive partners. The Spiritbreaker Nightstalker already being banned out could have fit the bill, but it is going to be a disruptor, so probably Bamboo Earthshaker regardless. I like the Team Empire draft quite a bit.
I mean, the concern I have for Team Empire's draft is that, oh, we are in the game. The concern I have for Team Empire's draft is that, yes, in the laning phase, they're going to be fine to get Havos just a little bit of farm, but it's going to be in the mid game where you have kind of low damage heroes. Again, we're seeing like Winter Wyvern. Last time it was Dazzle, this time it's Rubick. I guess Rubick has a little bit more damage output, but not really by that much. I was scared that they were just going to get run over, but now that it is going to be a side lane Shaker, Darkseer, Shadow Fiend, there's timings that Four Clovers can hit for sure, mostly based off of their ultimates and, of course, the mech on the Darkseer most likely. And that is potent, but is it actually going to be game-winning? I don't think that's going to be the case, and I think Empire, though they don't really have the best mid-game, they have enough mid-game to hold on so that the Anti-Mage can eventually get to the full Anti-Mage state that we all know and sometimes hate.
Yeah, as long as Empire don't get too over-aggressive and are like blinking under tower as a Queen of Pain and get caught out by rotations from 4CNL, I think they're in a pretty good spot just to farm this one through. As nice as it is to get a lot of farm on your Earthshaker in the Darkseer, unless you're going to be able to transition that to really big mid-game teamfights, it's going to be hard for 4CNL. That said, their mid-game teamfight is incredibly potent. If they get a Blink Dagger up for the Darkseer to click, you can get the back and back into Echo Slam, the Static Storm. The Wombo combo is definitely there. And as we've seen time and time again, even though it looks like they are a little bit lacking when it comes to their damage, because PyCat is playing so well around the rest of his teammates, it feels like they're able to make up for that apparent draft weakness.
They're going to get into a little bit of a squabble. Nikwa is going to charge the high ground with Ion Shell. PyCat's going to grab the Bounty Rune, and everyone just wants to leave. But Nikwa may not get that luxury. Lifted up into the air, and it looks like he will be first blood. Yes, drawn by Hippos. No fear, though, will fall, and an even one-for-one trade. Resolution has a blink out. He will not die here. Yoku, Freaky, rather. That's not Yoku. I don't know why I said that. Freaky, Aloha Dance, is going to be backing off. Almost a courier getting into a bad position. It looks like everyone will get back to safety, except for EGM, who feels a little bit suicidal. Is going to take the express route back to the base Resolution. Oh, he's going to be going up against PyCat. Long Ray's going to grab the kill! 360 no scope on that Queen of Pain. I have Blink, I'm safe. Not the correct thoughts from the Queen of Pain.
And just like that, Shadow Fiend's feeling pretty good about his situation inside this game. Granted, he didn't get souls for that kill. He didn't get Necromastery until after finishing off the Queen of Pain, but still, that is a huge start for the SF, as that propels him very close to his bottle. Not only does Queen of Pain lose a little bit of gold, but she also has to TP back to the lane. Now, starting out in a situation where SF has his bottle and just a couple hundred gold, whereas Queen of Pain only has 100 in her bank.
And this isn't as good as we saw PyCat get in game one, where he got first blood with Necromastery, but this is kind of close. Like, this is pretty much the realistic situation for PyCat's Shadow Fiend. And if you have a Shadow Fiend doing decently, usually you're okay. If you have PyCat's Shadow Fiend doing decently, you're going to be in a fantastic spot. And four Clovers really do need PyCat to get a lot out of this mid lane. And to some degree, that is going to be reliant on the stacks that his teammates create for him. Right now, well, can't look at it just yet. It seems like we're having a little bit of damage trade. Resolution does have to be a little bit careful. We'll blink out this time. Right now, a little bit of stacking going on. Not a ton, but I would expect that should be, for the most part, Sax's job. Hang around the Shadow Fiend a little bit, but in between these creep waves, go up there and start pulling and start stacking, and it will do probably just that. Maybe not.
Now, the same can't necessarily be said for Empire. They can clear stacks, but it's not as important for like the Darkseer and the Shadow Fiend, but still, one is going to be prepared by Aloha Dance. Is he just going for a drive-by as he looks to secure the bottom 2-minute rune, which is going to be a bounty for himself. Both of these offlaners, however, are getting a lot more than usually you'd expect. Darkseer, you kind of think that he's going to get his farm, and Nico is doing quite a good job at doing just that, but Funnik is left against an Earthshaker Disruptor dual lane, far from the most deadly.
There's really not much they can do. In fact, Funnik might have a chance to get a kill right now. He will get walled off. The snowball, oh, there's no vision. EGM's gonna chug down a salve, and Funnik will do the same. Salve will be canceled by EGM, and his is still running. Funnik will snowball over the fissure. Still trading hits right now. There's a Thunderstrike and a Glimpse. EGM only has enough mana for one. Funnik is going to chow down on the mango. He will be brought right back into Sexy Bambo's hands, who doesn't have a ton of mana left. Needs 10 more or just a truckload of right clicks to kill off this Tusk. Looks like Tusk should be able to make it back out. Throwing his shards is one last ditch effort before he goes back to the base. But you know, damage being traded effectively for Clovers, they get to send Tusk back to the base. And from this lane, I don't think they really were expecting that to happen. Like, this is a very low damage top lane.
Yeah, and Resolution continues to have a pretty mediocre time against the Shadow Fiend. This is usually the space in the early game where you look for Queen of Pain to have a CS advantage against the SF and to be doing quite well. But PyCat has a level lead, full level lead at that, and a good amount of farm more, especially with that solo kill. Now has boots on top of his bottle where Queen of Pain hasn't been able to get that regen up for the lane. It's very scary. He does have a salve, and he'll be able to stick around, but he's just taken one too many raises here. As 4CNR are getting farm across the board, whereas for Empire,
nice Shadow Strike, bro. Here comes the snowball, however. PyCat still has that DD, and is going to get a little bit help from the teleportation. Sax is always the one to do this. Funnik takes a couple of right clicks and a raise. And it is always, pretty much, as soon as PyCat feels he's in any sort of trouble at all, someone's going to teleport in, and until there's a Sonic Wave, Empire will not have enough burst damage to kill off SF before the Grave comes in.
Everything is going to slow down a little bit. Still, Hubos is free farming down the bottom lane. The Darkseer is in a situation where he can be comfortable top lane. They are going to be trading blows, no fear. They are going to have a fissure. Connects onto the Winter Wyvern with the Ice Shard, the EGM. One more attack from Funnik, and that is going to be lethal with the Disruptor's Glimpse. Just putting Funnik in a little bit of a better situation.
SF, he's invis, has a little bit more double damage. Oh, it runs out, but he should still be able to grab Funnik. One raise, one right click, that's a dead Tusk. No Fear still on the run. Bambo has another Fissure. He needs a perfect wall right now. That is not a perfect wall. No Fear just going to leave, and oh, it'll be interrupted. Bambo still gets the kill. Don't you just run and live? Right?
I think so, but oh, Winter Wyvern is going to get caught out with a little bit of a stretchy arm action coming out from the Earthshakers. He's able to reach over the top. Sax is dropping low. Thinks about graving and is going to have to do just that. Salves up.
There's a blink scream around.
Blink scream under the tower. There is a disruptor here too. Resolution is in a bit of trouble as these two supports might just be able to kill him off. Resolution getting way too greedy. 5-2. We've seen him go for those aggressive blinks on the Queen of Pain in game number 2 and on the Templar Assassin game number 1. And they've been punished very well by Forcino.
It's kind of rough to see him do that. I mean, it's a Dazzle who graved himself, was at 1 HP. He got a little bit of salve action, but just overshot, and yeah, you can screw pain blindly and get those kills, but if you miss it, you miss it. Bambo caught in the shards right now with the dragon overhead. He doesn't have that much mana. He's going to grab a level in Echo Slam, which is nice, but unfortunately, it's not going to be castable. No mana. It looks like he will eventually die. One more right click. There it is. Winter Wyvern going to draw a pretty easy kill on Bambo, a very gankable hero, that Shaker, as long as you're sure to keep your distance or make sure that he is low on mana.
Queen of Pain's getting a little bit more space in lane.
Oh, bottom lane. Niqua's in a lot of trouble right now. Hobos does have a mana void, and Niqua still has half mana pool. He will not die to it. He will get healed up as Zaxa comes in at just the nick of time. That could have been messy. There could have been Darkseer bits all over the place. Instead, Niqua gets to live.
So many saves from Zaxa this game already, and we're only 6 minutes into it. Just really nice TP rotations. It feels like he has a good idea of what's going to happen next. Just a good read on the situation. We'll secure a bounty rune for Pycat as he's going to refill his bottle and get all ready to go. In fact, everything's going to slow down a bit. 4CNR are giving a little bit of room to their supports.
This is pretty big. Pycat found a triple.
Nice.
Oh, baby. Oh, baby, a triple. But pre-GM, he's going to get caught out as No Fear. Doesn't have anything to bounce off a Splinter Blast, so a couple right clicks, it seems. Bambo, with the Fissure available, can't really get into a good enough angle, but yeah, that's a lot of cash going towards Pygat. That's a threat for Empire. As nice as it is to have stacks available for the Anti-Mage or the Queen of Pain down the line, Havos can't clear it out. He's nowhere near being able to clear it out. So you're kind of stacking for either the Darkseer or the Shadow Fiend. Over towards top lane, EGM. He's going to get kind of bailed out by the Fissure. Echo Slam will chain stun enough so that EGM can get some distance away, but Funic has boots and EGM does not. And he's going to get Walrus Punch up into the air. Sax is going to teleport in. Bambo can't really do that much to help. Second kill, I believe, for Funic. Yes, 2-1-1 as this Tusk is just running around without many answers.
And a lot of it comes down to the laning situation. He has been able to get his level 6 at a very fast timing window, and it's not impossible for him to just run away with this game and get a lot more kills rolling for himself. That in and of itself is not enough, though. Those two kills, although good, are not the end of the world for 4CNL. Been on more auxiliary targets, but yeah.
Oh, Freaky. He's in a little bit of trouble. He's going to get a lift up. He's still Thunderstruck. That means he's glimpsable. If he's in range, which he doesn't even need to be in range, run down by the Ion Shells. Death by a thousand stings, Rubick. Unfortunately, getting in a little bit too deep in order to, I believe, grab his Arcane Boots. Mission success, but at a cost. At least he gets them before he dies. Havost, is he diveable right now? Well, with the Tusk coming in, definitely not. He's going to blink forward and aggressively throw EGM shards. Will be thrown Havost. There is going to not get sent. No one's going to send back, in fact, because Funic dodged it. In fact, with the Snowball, they will still lose the Anti-Mage. However, as Niqua's Ion Shell doing way too much damage. Splinter Blast, though, plus Funic's Beatdown should kill off Niqua. And Resolution was also coming in if needed. That is going to be a death of Havost for two heroes. For Empire, that's fine to make a couple times, but they have to make sure that this Anti-Mage is always farming.
Oh, that's good for the Winter Wyvern and Tusk, but that fight should have been a lot cleaner for them. They don't put Havost into the Snowball. He takes a lot of damage while the Tusk is trying to initiate. And also the Magic Stick coming out from the Disruptor is one of the biggest turning factors in that fight because he pops it immediately as the Mana Void goes out. It did much less damage than Havost was banking.
This top lane is still a concern of mine. For Clovers, their Shadow Fiend is doing fantastically. Niqua's having some bumps along the way, but he's still well on his way to his mechanism. Should be about that 12-minute mechanism time that you're looking towards. Curious to see what the Shadow Fiend actually wants to go for. Last time, it was the Shadow Blade. I'm not sure if that's the build in this game. Maybe SNY might be a little bit more of a direct build, a little more useful, but they're going to go onto Aloha Dance right now. Surprise, Shadow Fiend. Melee raise, one more raise, medium. That's going to be an easy kill. Room service for Shadow Fiend. And it should also be this tower to fall, already very, very weak. But outside of that, Bambo feels like he needs to set things up in a big way when he gets his Blink Dagger. And Blink Dagger Shaker is very powerful for sure, but it's not as directly consistent as, say, a Blink Dagger Slardar, who can always be active as long as he has a crush. Shaker has a little bit more of a constraint, mostly because of cooldowns, but also because of mana issues.
Yeah, I think that's fair. In mid lane, Bamboo is going to take the Ice Shards, walled off a little bit. Fisher's going to be thrown over the way of Funnic, lifted up. They'll pull him back. Snowball's going to connect on the Zax, a punch up in the air. Sonic Wave Orb 2 with the scream. He's going to be lethal. Earthshaker is not going to be denied. Tusk will secure the kill with a couple of raises. However, Pycat gets a return onto one. Still a good fight for Empire. Nice Sonic Wave coming out from Resolution, getting involved. I believe that's our first Sonic Wave of the game.
Yeah, I mean, got two kills off of it, so can't be too upset there as Resolution. Bamboo, unfortunately, I don't think, realize that the Rubick didn't have level 6, so he was trying to cast Enchant Totem just to get rid of the Fissure as his last spell casted, and ultimately everyone just Delta Split away from the Echo Slam, so that situation that Earthshaker really needs to avoid. It's a situation that usually Earthshakers would love to go in if they have a Blink Dagger, but that's still 1,000 gold away for Bamboo. And it seems like the map is going to get somewhat constricted as up towards top lane where Earthshaker should be farming. EGM's instead going to get dove right now. Snowball's going to come in. This is a super dead disruptor right now. And there is no help coming in as well there shouldn't be. No one should be going up towards this top lane.
Yeah, they don't even need the punch to secure that kill onto the disruptor. They will be able to, after the fact, put a little bit of pressure onto this lane and maybe get a little bit of damage onto the tower, but we'll just have to wait and see. Earthshaker is going to be here to offer a little bit of Fissure support, and since it is maxed out, can delay this push. There's a lot of enemy heroes around this top area, and that is going to free up Pycat. He's ridiculously farmed. 6k net worth, near enough. It is just going to be a Sanji and Yasha for now, and I do like that more carry-oriented approach as he mops up the tier 1 tower in mid well before Empire gets any substantial damage top.
The Shaker has to be so careful up on top. Safe lane is just its name, but I don't really know if this is the safest place for Bamboo to be. He's getting a decent amount of farm as he's clearing off these creep waves as they come in, but you're up against Snowball, you're up against a Blink on the Queen of Pains. No, there's no Sonic Wave yet right now, but Bamboo, if he dies right now, that just is the worst feel bads of all time. So close to his Blink Dagger Havost. He's going to be in a similar situation, I suppose, on his quote-unquote safe lane, but he has TPs coming in. No Fear is going to open up with the Arctic around to Pycat. Requiem is going to be deployed. Immediately, there's a curse. There's a large punch as well. Pycat's going to get great. He's not going to die just yet. In fact, he's going to turn around, try to kill off Funnic. Melee Rays will be enough to kill off that Tusk, but Havos, he's going to jump right in, grab the last hit. A mega kill spree being ended by Havos, and they also jump forward, grab the Dazzle. Looks like Nyquist should be able to get out of here. Yeah, there's no more interrupts. But for Havos, he just cashed in so hard. That's his sword if he wants it.
That helps out a lot for Empire, but that was just really aggressive coming out from 4CNL. At any point in the game, unless you're stupidly far ahead, going behind a tier 2 Towers of Shadow Fiend like that is a little bit much. Of course, he did have the Shallow Grave behind him, but it feels like 4 Clovers might be a little bit overconfident going into that. Still, the game could go either way. Incredibly, even when it comes to net worth, slight gold advantage for 4CNL, slight experience advantage for Empire, nothing huge. But what is the Blink Dagger up for Bamboo's Earthshaker. 1-2-1. This is a very slow game coming out from Bamboo, mostly because he is playing on this hero. Let's see what he can do with this first Blink Echo.
It's going to have to do a lot, because again, Pycat's doing very well, but you can't really lean on Pycat solely to take the game. They need vacuum combos with, you know, static storms and echo slams and fissures and whatnot. They also need Fissure not to get stolen by Rubick, first of all. That's going to be pretty messy if that's actually going to happen. But right now, they're just going to cover Pycat, lay this Shadow Fiend out as bait. If they get someone, fine. If not, maybe they feel powerful enough to take these tier 2s, though Nikwa's mechanism is not there. He is going to put himself in the trees. Looks like he's going to survive for a little bit. He has backup incoming. This can be very bad for Empire since they have no idea that these heroes are going to be cutting them off. Someone's going to leave its Resolution. That makes it even better for Clovis. They do catch an angle onto three heroes. Anime just uses the flame. Blink, Echo Slam onto the X-Man. Static Storm is there as well. They do get the Grey Boss still stolen by Lotus. Lotus is going to try to teleport out. We'll get interrupted on his way out. He's going to fall. And now they're still chasing after Lotus. Nyquist is at least. I don't see a situation where Rubick gets out of this unless he steals Surge. The chase is on, but he's getting body blocked, and Nyquist is keeping up with him, and that will be the kill on the Rubick. 3-0 in favor of 4 Clovers. It's actually a pretty good thing that Resolution decided to get the hell out of there, because that could have been a 4-0.
Oh, that was very nasty. Once it happens, that's a mid-game teamfight power coming out from 4CNL. Is they're able to tap into it? The Echo Slam probably only connects on the one, but it doesn't matter. The Static Storm follow-up for it was great, and when you can find the Anti-Mage, you just go for it. Now they're going to go for a Tier 2 tower after the fact. Pycat has his complete SNY less than 14 minutes into the game. This guy just finds gold out of nowhere, even after dying once super aggressively behind the Tier 2 and bottom lane. Hasn't slowed it down in the slightest.
Tier 2 tower not going to die just yet, but 4 Clovers not going to give up. Fissure is there onto No Fear. Short comes back into the clutches of Pycat, who's immediately going to get cursed up as it is going to be Alola Dance to arrive first. Not exactly ideal, though. They will interrupt the cast of the Requiem. Pycat now has to deal with one too many heroes. The boss is going to once again interrupt the Requiem. He will finally get it off. They've already lost the disruption. Now Sonic Wave into Pycat. They'll bring him down with the Queen of Pain Scream. Resolution is going to grab the kill, but oh, Shaker snipes the Winter Wyvern in the end. Should be able to get out of there with his Blink Dagger. I mean, for 4 Clovers, you could slow push this, but going in super deep behind the Tier 2 tower, when you know that the enemies are prone to teleporting in, it already happened that way. It's again 4 Clovers biting off a little bit more than they could chew without the mechanism. They need so badly for Nikwa to be in those types of fights.
Second burst, same as the first. This time around, however, the Requiem doesn't come out before the Winter's Curse.
Oh, they're gonna
Fissure,
catch
Blink, and Enchant Totem. Ooh. That's gonna be Bambo with the solo onto the Rubick. He was just going for a D word, poor guy. But yeah, I'd recommend staying away from behind that Tier 2 tower. It hasn't worked out. That was really well executed by Empire. Shadow Fiend, he tried so hard to get that Requiem off, but every single time, interrupt after interrupt after interrupt. And by the time he finally got it, nobody was even close.
Bambo is showing off how much damage he can do. Doesn't even have many
smoke
points
bottom,
in Enchant Totems. Yeah, he's going to smell something coming. He's going to bail out.
Okay.
And he is well on his way towards a 4 staff, I would imagine. But 4 Clovers, if they have all their teamfight ultimates, if they have Vacuum into anything, hell, Darkseer into anything, just being there with the mechanism is sometimes good enough. I could see 4 Clovers sometimes taking those teamfights. Maybe get a glimpse back onto someone very early. I think he did glimpse back someone. Do you... I don't know.
It was the short glimpse on the Winter Wyvern.
Right, right, right. So, you know, save glimpse for the TP's back if you're going to dive. So,
yeah.
It's kind of less than ideal usage of the spells for 4 Clovers. However, now they're looking for mid lane. They do see No Fear. They don't see anyone else, and that's a problem. Don't want to jump in Echo. If you're Slaughter, you Blink Crush that all day long, man. But, you know, Earthshaker commits a little bit harder than a Slaughter because Earthshaker doesn't have Sprint. However, this is Alola Dance. In a really bad position. Here comes a random and illusion rune, but it's not going to make it much of a difference since still Lohanis should fall. Bambo is going to, well, get cursed up, but really, who cares? Mech should keep everyone safe enough to go for this push. So guys, don't dive to Tier 2, just kill it.
I think Empire care that they use the Winter's Curse there. It's going to make it very difficult for them to push into this Tier, or to defend into this Tier 2. The good news is that Sonic Wave is off of cooldown. In 1 second, Resolution Albert doesn't have a lot of mana. He actually can't TP and respond. This is probably going to be a Tier 2 tower. Before CNL, we'll have to see if they're able to pull this one off. They have backed off EGM, and Nikwa also is not with the team. So it looks like 4 Clovers have gotten cold feet.
Resolution still sticking around this bottom lane. I'm pretty sure the intent for EGM was to wait for someone to show their face. He was looking for probably Havost, or wait for someone to show their face, trying to split push, trying to race, and then interrupt their TP with the glimpse. Probably isn't going to get that to happen, although EGM... Bro, there's a Fissure that's going to be thrown. Bambo doesn't have a Blink Dagger, however. Resolution is tracked up because of that Thunderstrike. However, he will now lose his tracking. Blink into the trees. There's an Echo Slam. Don't do it, Bambo. Please, no. Okay, good, good, good. That was a jank-ass combo from the Disruptor.
Didn't work out as intended. I was half expecting Bambo to go for the Echo Slam there, I'll be honest.
No, man. That's a little bit too much.
But what he is going to get is... well on his way towards his 4 staff. He almost has that completed. And for an Earthshaker, this is a very good
one. Oh, top. Oh, that Snowball actually wasn't going towards him. Never mind.
Even if it does, there's a mechanism on this Darkseer. It's pretty hard unless you get the Mana Void after the mech has been popped, and even then, it probably buys enough time for the rest of his team to back him up there, so... we'll just slow things down. We'll go back to farming. But still, that... I've thought in the back of your mind is nagging for CNL that Havost has gotten a lot of free space. He's died a handful of times this game, but for quite a while. He's been left with some quality time inside his own woods, and is now second highest net worth in the game. Granted, still quite a long ways away behind the Shadow Fiend, but for an Anti-Mage, 2,000 gold is only a couple of minutes.
3,000 gold difference isn't really going to make this game for 4 Clovers. They really need to look for another big team fight. Really, at some extent, doesn't matter where that team fight is even going to happen. Near Roche to grab a Roche, that's great. Bambo, though, needs to not die right now. Sonic Wave Brave is there. Bambo will throw a Fissure, but it will not do much versus Resolution. Gets the BKB up, and Bambo will finally get the Echo Slam off. Only onto Funic, however, Vacuum Wall only onto one again. Still Funic. He's not even going to die. Okay, he will die, but Resolution is going to Blink out of there. A 1-for-1 trade thus far. Everyone chasing forward, not really doing that much. I mean, that is fine for 4 Clovers as far as the hero-hero trade is concerned, but Empire, they're just buying space here for Havost, who's getting so much split push action up towards top lane. And for 4 Clovers, they're on a very significant timer because Havost is very soon going to reach critical mass.
Yeah, it's scary for them. Pycat's going to go back for the Shadow Blade. I think his mind's in the right place. He wants to get aggressive, wants to try and force these fights, and that's one way to do it. Is it going to be enough, though? I think only time will tell. Oh, Disruptor bumps into the Antimage. Just is not a hero that you want to man fight pretty much ever. However, if you can get a glimpse. Oh, maybe. Blink in. Fisher walls off, too. Avos does have a blink out, but he's going to be glimpsed back into the Static Storm. No blink for you. Fights against Bambo. The physical damage is pretty big. He's going to be able to mop up one. Going for EGM. Mops up two. Double kill for Avos. And now he's going to look for Nequa. There's a Shallow Grave. Surge away. The Darkster's going to get out. Saxa. Yeah, he also will be able to retreat. Still, that was Forcinel trying to fight a boast. Even now,
oh, Pycat has items. Requiem onto Resolution. Oh, yeah.
No.
Feels good, man, if you're Pycat. It wasn't quite 100-0, but it gets the job done because you don't expect that as the Queen of Pain. Hopefully, she got a good look that it was Shadow Blade instead of an Invis Rune. I don't think they have confirmation on that just yet if they didn't get a look, which can be really bad. May not expect it down the line, but. That was Bambo failing to use anything after the fissure, so giving that one freely over to the Rubick. And if that fissure doesn't get stolen, if it's not returned to the Four Clover side, I dare say they do get the kill on the Antimage and probably just go on their way. But instead, Antimage turns around, grabs a handful of kills, accelerating his farm even further as if he even needs it. The kill up for Pycat is great. I mean, no one's going to deny that, but the Antimage getting those kills just matters so much more for Empire than Pycat's kills do. Four Clovers, though they are going to slide right into the Roche Pit. Pycat does have himself a DD rune, and this Roche is not going to last long at all because of it.
No, absolutely not. Even by himself, he probably could take it out, but this way there is no risk. He has extra armor from the Dazzle. The mechanism is there for Nequa. They didn't even get to pop it. That's a second life for Pycat's Shadow Fiend, and that's pretty scary. Although this game could still go either way, for CNL, if they can find a good opportunity with their Darkseer involved inside these fights, I'm tempted to say that they have a pretty vast advantage, but we haven't seen everything come together.
Not like this.
Yeah. Winter Wyvern is so dead.
Nice embrace, bro. Oh, man. Rare Raze is just going to cut right through that. It is a nice kill for the Shadow Fiend. He's going to shove this lane, and it looks like the rest of the team looking to shove over in mid. Antimage is approaching critical mass very quickly, but crucially, he is not there yet. Bambo still has his ultimate, as does EGM. In fact, everyone on Four Clovers, they are ready to go. Soon, in eight seconds, the Shadow Fiend will be fully ready to go as well. And Empire, nope, they're going to jump in. Fissure is going to intercept Bambo on the incoming. They're going to glimpse back Alola Dance into a vacuum. Bambo gets a really nice Echo Slam onto, and Saxa steals both of those kills. Easy 2-kill for Four Clovers, and now Pygat's going to arrive. He's the battering ram. This tower is going to fall, and they're going to try to race. Double buyback? No, just one, actually. Well, Winter Wyvern just responds naturally. But buyback is up now on the Tusk, but Four Clovers, damn, they're not going to stop. However, they do not have their ultimate, so this is time to stop. Oh, EGM going to get cursed up, and Pycat is going to kill off his ally, or at least do the vast majority of the damage in doing so. Now, Four Clovers kind of have to leave. Aegis or not, with no ultimate, there is no fight. Nequa, though, is going to get caught in the shards. It's going to surge away from the snowball. Looks like that will not connect. Sonic Wave will be deployed. Pycat Requiem is going to be, for the most part, dodged. Funic still is running away. Looks like he should be fine. Shards will wall off Pycat, yet shove Nequa out. I don't think they want to mess with Pycat here. He has double life. And it looks like that should just about be it. They crush those two supports. They annihilate them. But that, of course, means they can't push any longer. That means there's more space for Hervost.
So the Urshaker is able to repel the Antimage before he does too much damage to that Tier 3 tower. He did get a lot of split push in. About a third of the damage has been dealt. But is that enough? I'm not so sure. Pycat is still incredibly strong. Now with the BKB, I think Force Enel are ready for round number two. Aegis is still there for about 3 minutes now.
Oh,
and he's Shadowblading forward. Shadowblade hit going to hit very hard onto Funic. He has a snowball. They do have the Golden Brace, but again, that doesn't do anything to raises. Turn around for the third race. He has the mechanism, but with a long range fish. Earthshaker gonna snipe it. Resolution gets the blink out, so at least he'll be fine. But that's a dieback on the Tusk. He's down for a minute.
Classic first hit maim, dude. Everyone complains about first hit bash, but sometimes you just need a little bit of extra chasing power. Ultimates that are up. Static Storm, Echo Slam in 30. There is a vacuum wall available, and 40 seconds until Requiem. Oh, Bambo, he's going to try to leave. He will get out. Takes a little bit of damage for his troubles, but he will be able to hold this top lane tier 1. The ultimate on Shaker means that you're kind of willing to throw him over out of the fight and look for something else. Resolution. Oh, I mean, they really need the Thunderstrike and a Glimpse back if they're going to get that kill. But this is Four Clovers playing as they have to up against an Anti-Mage, at least right now what they're doing with this Aegis especially. But if they can't find a way in, then they can't find a way in, and Havost is working with soon-to-be a Mantis style. Has Yasha, has Ultimate Orb money, and then Recipe is just a hop, skip, and a jump away.
Yeah, and if you can get on top of especially the Darkseer, that Mana Void can do a lot of damage. Still, the Guardian Greaves and the Soul Ring, if popped appropriately, can delay or reduce that damage inside the fight. I'm not sure if that's going to come out, but still, it's a very crucial tool. And Anti-Mage, at the very least, is strong enough to be able to do that if he doesn't get CC'd. If the Earthshaker can jump to that might be the case. He'll lose his Aegis or not. Backing back. No follow-up yet. Nikwa's going to be pulled back. Four staff away, however. And a Surge out too. They even retain the secondary life on the SF, but Anti-Mage is working on that tier 3 already very low. Habos eventually going to be able to get. Now, can you get out cleanly? He's going to be able to get that blink, and yeah. That works out for Empire as they have a successful split push up towards top.
And he'll teleport away, all the way. He'll be just fine. That is four Clovers again doing what they have to do, but going up against Anti-Mage is getting more and more items. He can split push, he can probably race. Four Clovers have a decent amount of farm on this Shadow Fiend, but this is really where Shadow Blade as an item becomes a lot worse. If you're keeping the fights in the middle of the map, then Shadow Blade is going to be aces. You can get those kills like we just saw in the Winter Wyvern on the bottom lane, where you just jump on them and kill them off, or land a perfect Requiem on a Queen of Pain, things like that. If you're going up high ground, it gives you a little bit of damage, it gives you a little bit of attack speed, but the invis is largely wasted, so for four Clovers, this is kind of Pycat needing to do much more damage than he has right now. That's not to say that itemization will be enabling them to do this, but it's kind of Pycat with the only source of damage in the game right now. He has to be the one to do it, otherwise no one else is.
There's your Mantis Sal delivered to Havos. Smoke up from Empire. Five heroes going to make this rotation. It's going to be a big fight if it does end up happening. Looks like Empire might be guessing the wrong direction, though. They're going to walk up towards the high ground, maybe bump into Nikwa here. The Darkseer is going to walk around the corner, or is he?
He has a Blink Dagger, though. It is, even if you run into him, Nikwa may just blow the smoke and get out of there. Plus, his allies are right around the corner. Full health restore for the Shadow Fiend right now. Oh, running into Saxon, that's much better. Punic knows that someone's here. Doesn't know who it is. And he's going to be happy that it's a Dazzle, but oh, he's not going to be happy that they have Pycat right in their sights. Weave is going to be applied to everyone on Empire. They have to evacuate right now. They can't afford to lose anyone right now. Blink in, Nikwa's gonna catch. One with the vacuum. Aloha Dance and Funic in a lot of trouble. BKB actually gets used by Pycat. Funic will fall. Freaky is going to get glimpsed out of his TP right into Nikwa's clutches. That's gonna be a two kill. They do use the BKB on the Shadow Fiend. However, they do not use any of their ultimates, which means they can push.
That heal from the Dazzle did so much damage, even without having a lot of targets. That minus armor, we saw the power of it when Shadow Fiend's hitting on the Tusk. That's supposed to be a reasonably tanky hero against physical damage with the mech, but yeah, Pycat is a truck. He's going to go for the tier 3 tower and be able to take that very cleanly, but up towards top lane, Invis Bambo Shadow Bladed up. He wants to go for Bush. He'll get the Echo Slam after in the Static Storm. Habos in a lot of trouble here. The Mantis will be popped. They keep him inside the storm. He turns around and now blink out. They'll glimpse him back, but do you really want to fight against Habos? Another Enchant Totem hit. Habos juking through the trees. Has another blink. Going to look for the TP. Blind Fissure not available, and Habos will retreat.
These two heroes just don't do that much damage. Bambo is trying to get in there ASAP. But the creep wave, the dire creeps did enough damage to kill off the radiant creep wave, which means that the Echo Slam just didn't do enough damage. If Sexy Bambo got there just like 5 seconds faster, for sure that would have been a kill because you have a little bit more damage done with the Echo Slam. That would have made the difference. That's tipping the scales. Or if he has level 4 Enchant Totem, that can also be tipping the scales in favor of 4 Clovers. But ultimately, they get almost a tier 3 tower, which of course means they get nothing. And they don't get Havos, and they have to expend both Static Storm and Echo Slam to not get him. That was a huge escape for Empire, and now they might actually catch the Shadow Fiend. He has a BKB, might not be able to get it off in time, and even if he does, everyone can just disengage. Resolution dropping very low, however. Pycat still on the run. Funic is going to wall him off with the shards, has a Walrus Punch, and something's stolen, probably a short raid or something like that. Not a huge one for Aloha Dance. Pycat, second BKB charged, used for these very small skirmishes, less than ideal when you need this BKB to push up high ground.
Yeah, and it's already down to 8 seconds, although 8 seconds is still pretty darn good. Any more, and this does get very scary for them, is there's good ways that they can waste the time of that magic community. He can't get off a Requiem channel very easily with Walrus Punch, with the Anti-Mage's ultimate, with the Winter's Curse, although they might not want to use those spells in such a manner. They at least have that option for them, so Pycat is going to find it a little bit more difficult to fight inside the next couple of engagements, especially now that Boast has overtaken him when it comes to raw net worth, Snowball, and mid.
Oh, they're going to not catch up to anyone. Anti-Mage Illusions being a nuisance. Oh, vacuum back though. He's going to catch two. Bambo does not have his stunning tools. Resolution, BKB, blink out. Funnick's going to get yanked right back in. Glimmer Cape, embrace. Nice for a couple seconds, Funnick, but I don't see you escaping this one, bro. Mega Kill Spree being picked up by Pycat. again, it's a small pick. Oh, No Fear. They see him. They definitely see him. They're pinging him out. Don't move, No Fear. It's too late. Nico's going to jump right in. Heal Bomb is there. Winter Wyvern is also going to fall. And it seems
Shadow
like
Fiend.
Exact same play. Get these kills. Try to go for her Havos, but double invis. Double Shadow Blade, man. He's going to blink straight to the left. There is going to be a Disruptor kind of cutting him off, but not fast enough. Off of those two kills without using any of your ultimates, you kind of need to go for high ground there, I feel, but they really, really want to shut down this Anti-Mage. Is that the right choice?
I don't think they have successfully shut down, even if they get that kill.
They kill Aloha Dance here?
Maybe. Glimmer. Vacuum back, and he's in a lot of trouble. He does have the Glimmer Cape, so maybe Niqua's going to be denied this kill. Juking through the trees is not going to happen. Yeah, he's caught in the corner. One karate chop, and Niqua's on a killing spree.
He doesn't get the tower either, as Aloha Dance feels bad, man. Tower will be claimed by Niqua. That is still four Clovers getting these kills, but all these kills and all the wrong places, like right outside their own towers, they want to be getting kills right outside the enemy base. I mean, that's what they're looking for, and they want those kills almost exclusively to be on Havos. I'm sure they'll settle for Resolution, who's shown to be not super tanky even with the BKB, but four Clovers, they need like a lot of pickoffs on a lot of these heroes if they're going to counterbalance the super farmed Anti-Mage.
Yeah, I really want to see Resolution go for a plate mail item. It's the physical damage that's really doing him in. Only 5 armor, at least when he's on strength treads. He just doesn't have a lot of tankability when it comes to the Shadow Fiend and the Dazzle. We'll be able to rip through that very quickly. Oh, up towards top. We're going to ping out Bambo, and here comes a rotation from No Fear and Resolution. They've been tagged by Dazzle Ultimate. Havos is going to blink in, but this kind of gives us a feel for how Havos evaluates the game right now. He's very comfortable going for those aggressive plays.
Of course, he does have two allies right behind him, and he's going in for a Shaker. So it's not impossible to just get that kill solo as an Anti-Mage. Maybe a lot easier once you have your Basher, but speaking of Basher, he has dough enough for anything. 4,500 gold, this Anti-Mage has some spending money to say the least, and he is slow sieging this mid lane. 2-3 has already fallen from before, and 4 Clovers. It almost feels like they're playing up against the Naga Siren. It's like that type of gameplay where they always get a kill here or there, but ultimately they can't really break the base because there is this rat that they have to deal with. Set some traps or something, guys, because Havos is keeping Empire's base from being pushed just by bouncing around all over the place and threatening high ground Raxes, on the top lane Raxes to die. For Clovers, though, they do have a chance to grab Roshan, and that means that they're going to be more willing to just YOLO up the high ground and try to race Havos' split push.
Jettafiend does have a Satanic. Will help with the sustain going for the push. Walking around the corner.
By No Fear. Oh my god. Is that 3 hits? Oh, he's going to get himself glimmered. Vacuum back. No Fear still flying, but he will eventually fall. And EGM's going to take a Sonic Wave. That's not a good one from Resolution. EGM is actually still alive right now. Snowball is coming in. It looks like it might kill him, but not with the Guardian Grease. Funnick is overcommitted. They've already taken down the Winter Wyvern. Now they're onto Funnick. That Static Storm isn't a good one either. Funnick's going to try to TP out, but Bambo's right there to stun it up. Someone kill off Funnick. There it is. Jumping forward now, looking for a Aloha Dance. They will miss the Fissure. Aloha Dance, he's trying to hide. Don't move, bro. Oh, he's gonna get away! Oh, but in the meantime, Havos, he's gonna blink straight into Pycat. He's gonna lose all of his mana right now. Havos just wants to blink out. He just wants to leave, and it looks like he'll blink up to the north. Maybe looking for that Disruptor pick, but no, it's probably gonna be him to fall back. It's just a 2-kill.
Oh, blink in! Mana Void! Looking for EGM. He's under the tier 3 towers. Havos really wants this.
He got him.
He glimpsed out. Oh my goodness. I really didn't think he'd go for it, but he did, and he pulls it off. Vacuum is a little too late, so he's going to be out fine.
And that being said, it is just a Disruptor to be lost, whereas for Empire, they did lose their Queen of Pain as well as their Tusk. So the numerical advantage is still going to be... Oh, wait, that was actually another kill. Okay, well, Queen of Pain got dropped to the Shaker. I was going to say they didn't use Echo Slam, but they did use Echo Slam to get Queen of Pain. So even better there for 4 Clovers. That's a 3-for-1 after all is said and done. Pycat is going to grab his double life. Has, was that just Satanic gold? Yeah, it seems like all his gold was going into that Satanic. This is super useful for 4 Clovers, but this Anti-Mage, we can see, he's just so difficult to deal with, especially now that he has a Butterfly. I think before the Butterfly, Shadow Fiend can duel the Anti-Mage decently, but after it, he needs an MKB to even have a chance.
We have a Silver Edge on the Earthshaker,
maybe.
Though.
That'll get the job done, man.
Yeah.
Talk about Initiation.
Take away that Spell Shield, which Anti-Mage actually has maxed out this game. There's a lot of magical damage coming out from your auxiliary heroes, and even the raises to a lesser extent. Havos HP pool is not that impressive. If he's forced to use the Mantis Cell early, or if he does use the Mantis Cell to push a little bit more...
Ooh. Let's see it. You could annihilate the Rubick also. There is no Echo Slam here. It's going to sit right on top of Low Dance. Oh my god, that is a disgusting amount of damage from one hit and then another one.
He has the gem. There is no hiding from Bambo.
Rip Rubick. Havos, though, he's still being chased down. Bambo will lose a good amount of mana. Pycat, he does not have a Silver Edge. And Havos should just bail out of here. Oh, he's going to farm. Not a good idea, Havos. Or is it? Oh, Bambo is still a little bit too far away. He will escape. And EGM, same thing.
Boost is A-OK, 18 to 31. 4C and Elf do have the advantage when it comes to kills. However, it doesn't feel like they're getting much closer to pushing high ground yet, since this anti-mage is still a massive nuisance for them. What's the factor that's going to allow them to actually take the base?
I don't really think it's going to come from any huge items, although, you know, Aghanim
Scepter just has to be a pick-off on Havost, right?
Yeah, or a pick-off on Havost is going to be the biggest thing, or a pick-off on, like, two other heroes while Havost is not in a good split-pushing position. It has to be the right amount of kills and the right hero kills at the right time. It's a lot to ask for. Funnik also, I mean, needs to not die for Empire to have a chance in this game. He's going to shard the hill.
Oh, glimpse back. Havost might be in a little bit of trouble here. Echo Slam held in place. They have the Aghanim Static Storm. Havost, is he taking enough damage?
I don't think so.
They just can't kill him off. They needed somebody else there, and that somebody else is Pycat as he comes in with the Shadow Blade. Resolution is down towards the south. Fissure is going to catch out Havost. He's not TPing, though. He has another blink. TP out. Back in from Niqua. He's going to catch Havost. He does have another blink in 1 second. Can he get a live mana point? He's fighting them, but not well enough. Sonic Wave, they'll get one in return, and now Resolution showing his position. He has another blink. Soon.
Oh, he found Bambo!
He gets the Earthshaker kill gem on the deck for Resolution. Try for the DP out.
You don't have vision? Ooh, he got away.
Get it.
Are you kidding me? What the hell is going on in this game?
What a mess.
Okay, but for Clovers, they got Havost, which means they still have a little bit more Aegis. They still have at least a chance on busting up the high ground. Right now, they probably aren't expecting Raxus. They want to test if Havost wants to use his buyback. And that in and of itself will be a little bit of a win for the four Clovers side. But, man, that was Butterfly causing problems. Earthshaker trying to land an Enchant Totem hit. I believe tried three times and missed all three times. So, feels bad, man, for sure. This Earthshaker needs an MKB. Dude, get MKB Shaker. You're going to be golden. Pycat will claim a tower. That's kind of nice. Now, trying to force out the buyback. He's having to deal with no fear resolution. Funnik, he's really swarmed, actually, by heroes. They have a lift up. They will probably be able to take down this first life. And Pycat will fall, but his backup is coming very quickly. But it's not really a ton of backup to start off with. Sax is going to get snowballed in. Walrus Punch should kill him off. It's not available. They'll kill him off regardless. In the meantime, they lose the Winter Wyvern. So far, a one-for-one trade. Pycat still imposing, but not dangerous enough. He's going to shove out of the shards. In fact, gem on the deck. Someone pick it up. There it is. Courier, also, you should get the hell out of here. Everyone's going to leave. The pickoff on Havost, ultimately not good enough for Clovers to push in because they lost a little bit too much.
Just like that, the game is going to commence at much the same pace that it has been for quite a while now. Anti-Mage keeps on pushing out. Shadow Fiend, as farmed as he is, I'm not sure if it's enough. We have a Scythe of Ice on Darkseer, though. That definitely makes getting those pickoffs on Havost or otherwise a lot easier for them. The counterplay to that Hex is the BKB on the Queen of Pain, but outside of that, no great tools directly on the heroes. They need to make sure that Winter Wyvern's in position to maybe make a turn, but I don't know. It's going to be really hard. Aloha Dance. This is not the right neighborhood.
Bambo's like, are you alone? You're alone, bro. That means you're dead. A blink forward. Oh, God. That was 500-something damage. They use a Static Storm because the cooldown isn't super long. I'm pretty sure Bambo could have done that by himself, but why take chances, right? It's a super dead Rubick, but that pickoff is not quite good enough to make any sort of super aggressive play, especially with no Aegis.
Yeah, they didn't know exactly who was behind him. They saw him in the lane, but they didn't know if somebody was like TPing in to back him up. That's probably why they used the Static Storm there, even though it was probably completely unnecessary, not going to impact the game in the slightest. Dirge Tower in mid is going to take quite a bit of damage from a handful of Manta Illusions thrown there by the Anti-Mages. Havost continues to farm up. He's getting really close to having all of his slots filled with pretty important items. Granted, he can, by Moonshard, replace that Vladimir's offering, but he's getting close to pick. Oh, Winter Wyvern?
Okay. I should stop not watching
Just
Bambo.
Just watch Bambo. Yeah, exactly.
All the time.
Shaker.
Or at least, like, keep him selected so that I see when cooldowns go off. That was an Echo Slam for a Wyvern, though. That's a minute downtime in between Wyvern coming back online and the Echo Slam still being down. So it's expensive as hell for the 4 Clover side to make that exchange. For Clover's EGM. Maybe jump by Funnik. But over the meantime, Saxa will get pop resolution. Wall's deployed, but it's not going to do a ton. In fact, Wall now stolen by Aloha Dance. There's no great targets for it. Resolution can take a hell of a lot of damage. He's putting the snowball. Wall now crisscrossing in. Havost is going to come right in. Backing back into Wall is decent, but Pycat is too slow on the incoming. And it looks like it'll be Four Clovers trying to start a fight without their Shadow Fiend, without their ultimates. Kind of suicidal.
Yeah, that was a little bit awkward coming out from them. And yeah, they just had the right heroes in the right places. Still, I do want to take a second to talk about the Earthshaker coming out from Bambo. This is a classic Bambo hero. Way back when he was playing with Zephyr, and just in general, something that is pleasant to see every once in a while, even though it hasn't been something they've been falling back on recently.
I mean, it is kind of similar in that Slaughter. In fact, in the way you want to, you know, blink around, kind of keep pace with the damage. Shaker definitely has enough to instigate people, whereas Slaughter needs a lot extra to get that going. It's usually gold that we don't see picked up. So, yeah, again, it does fit Bambo pretty darn well, and he's going to go for crit. Okay, so 500 with Enchant Totem, add a multiplier to that. Not looking at one hit kill just yet, but it's sure as hell getting close. I guess you're looking for damage. Could be anyone, might as well be the Shaker.
1444, that puts him almost at a kill onto the Rubick with resistance, probably not instantly, but you bet with a couple of extra spells thrown in. If he has a pre-prepped Enchant, just blink in, Fissure Smack, Enchant Smack, certainly a dead support.
Pycat fluttering forward is going to spot out Funic. Is that in range for a glimpse back? Looks like no one is just yet. Vision is going to be given to Pycat, at least to some extent. Pycat's walking alone in the river right now. He's going to get jumped by a Vos, immediately misses all of his attacks. Pycat will be silenced, but he has BKB, and I don't really know if he cares about the silence to begin with. In the back line, Saxon, a lot of trouble. He will survive for a little while longer, but now Echo Slam onto a Vos. Pycat is going to get cursed out of his Requiem right now. Pycat will not take any damage from that. He's not going to cast Requiem. He's going to turn around and try to wail on a Vos to get back into a wall resolution. He's going to try to get away from this one, and Pycat can't even move. He has to fight up against a Vos, but no one's really taking that much damage from that exchange. It's only Bambo to die right now, though. There's a snowball. I think that's the Tusk, and he's going to go right into a field right now. Resolution needs to blink down, but he can't quite get it off. Pycat will Requiem, do so much damage to Avos, he will die in the end. Now it's going to be Niquan to fall, and EGM, he's going to try to run, but it's not going to happen. Avos is going to grab a triple kill, double gems on the deck. It's a 4-2 exchange, and now the doors are wide open for Empire to go for Raxes.
Tank 2 Requiems, no problem. The Anti-Mage had nothing to fear after the Shadow Fiend falls down, and even when the Shadow Fiend's up, without having an MKB on the SF, it's really just a toss-up who wins that man fight. And Avost with the Basher advantage probably takes it out, especially now that he has that Abyssal Blade. The double walls in these fights have been pretty darn crazy too. It really feels like Empire is starting to pick up momentum. They actually do get a stun onto Avost from the maxed out Poison Touch. Oh, here comes EGM.
No.
Sky High. Oh, now he's going on to the next kill. Bash on the Sax. A double for Avost. And now straight to the melee. And Rage Barracks also. 4CL have not a single buyback. Bambo's up in 5 seconds. They're going to lose two lanes.
This is looking really bad for Four Clovers. Empire might be taking game three in just a little bit, guys. Usually Anti-Mage plays, like when it gets to the stage, you can say, oh man, Anti-Mage just going off. And usually there's people who have made a lot of space for him. I feel like in this game, Havos kind of made his own space. Like his allies were getting picked off left, right, and center. He was up towards top lane. That was Havos' domain. And that's really what prevented Four Clovers from going in, and the fact that Anti-Mage was just being a rat the entire time. Granted, Empire, they were making a little bit of space so that Anti-Mage could have gotten the Battle Fury beforehand, but now that two Raxes are in their favor with the rat that we've already seen from Havost, Four Clovers, they're going to need the team fight of miracles if they want to kill off the Anti-Mage and have enough to push all the way back into Empire's base.
It's going to be really hard. Now Havost, casually sitting on 6,000 gold, what's it going to be for you? It's going to be a full heart. Why not casually buy that one up? He's six-slotted.
Dude, you gotta eat your moon shards. Grow nice and healthy and eat your moon shards. Well, we also have an Aghanim Scepter being completed actually on Rubick, who's been on point with making his steals. If he can keep stealing from that Earthshakers, keep stealing the Fissures, maybe grab an Echo Slam, Wall, Static Storm, all at a super premium, then Empire, they'll be sitting pretty. Even two racks behind, four Clovers, have a chance to grab Roshan right now, and Empire, they're just too far away to contest.
This is a small glimmer of hope for 4CNL, but this game feels very close to out of reach. As much as we've been talking about how Havost resolution is also quietly farmed up as they blink forward, silence up onto EGM, Sonic Wave is not going to clip onto the Disruptor, but they will be able to bring down Sax. The Disruptor is going to throw down his Static Storm pretty good, but not good enough. Winter's Curse as the Echo Slam's onto the back lines, vacuum free under the wall, but the follow-up, is there enough damage? I don't think so. It's just the resolution that Havost shows. They go for Pycat. Havost fighting against the Shadow Fiend with Satanic is going to live a little while longer, but the Bash is Havost is unstoppable, and he truly is they'll be able to bring down three heroes completely unanswered. Even the Winter Wyvern is still chasing forward for Bambo. When Enchanto to hit Bambo, he wants it. He has the Aegis, so that's at least something for them, but this is going to be Mega Creeps for Empire.
That's GG. The Shadow Fiend has no buyback. Havost is at full HP, and Empire, they can just put everyone on the front lines right now. Bambo may get a snipe on No Fear, but honestly, that's fine. No Fear has already done his job and then some. All the building on 4 Clover side will fall. Oh, they're also going to catch Sexy Bambo. One more for the road. Oh, Timur actually, because he has the Aegis. Can you blink out of here, Earthshaker? Yes, but to what end? Because you're blinking towards a boat. That's not really where you want to go. He's going to get a little help from Nico, but Nico actually doesn't have that much except for a Vacuum and Sheepstick right now, which we'll use on the Anti-Mage. Vacuum back as well, but Pycat's going to call it. 45 minutes in. This is an Anti-Mage game through and through for Empire, and 4 Clovers are unable to break the high ground in time.
You know, a lot of people had doubts about Havost standing in for Empire and playing with them throughout this tournament, but I think he's put throughout the group stage, and especially in this game, all of those doubts to rest. A very impressive performance coming out from him, but even more so, I think 4CNL were just pulled apart by that Anti-Mage. We never really saw a huge teamfight where everything lines up together. We saw two parts of the puzzle being put together quite often, but never that full Vacuum into Static Storm Echo Slam. And without it, 4 Clovers really found it difficult to take any fights super convincingly, but in the end, Empire had control of the map, and it's so hard to win against an Anti-Mage when Havost is in control.
Yeah, big shout out to Funic as well. Those snowballs, pain in the ass for 4 Clovers to actually deal with. Once the snowball comes up, you literally can't do anything. Guys, this is going to be Game 3 claimed by Empire, one game away from taking first place here at DreamHack Moscow. I'm Mike Lawrence, been joined by Grandis, who we're now going to send it back down to see what the panel has to say about that game.
Stadium Live. I'm Lumis, joining here on the expert panel with Gods as well as Ming-Li.
How does an expert panel differentiate from other types of panels? What are the different types of panels?
You got the ones where Toby's on it. You got the argumentative ones with LD on it.
Mm-hmm.
You got the Merlini panel.
Is that just like the three Merlini panel? Or just any panel with Merlini?
Merlini, Winter, myself, or Blitz.
Chobra.
We got to make that happen for Shanghai.
Yeah. Okay, any other types of panels?
No, that's it. The rest is just not a panel.
Okay.
All right.
So we're the expert panel. What makes us the expert panel?
Because we have Winter.
I'll play it.
I was about to question my ability to be defined as an expert there.
Well, you are an aspiring 2K caster.
Yes.
That's very unique.
Could be the first of my kind.
Yes. All right, first of your kind. Break it down to us and tell us why it's going to be 3-1 Empire.
Because 4CL are on a bit of tilt right now. I think this game they dropped had a good purpose. I like the Earthshaker pick and how it just fit in and put Bambo in a hero he can make plays with. Like, he was running around kind of solo, or at least with EGM, like with the one support, looking for those kills. So, for the most part, they just didn't quite work. Like, Anti-Mage was one item too far ahead, maybe. I think more than anything, it was just like a classic, like, Navi-esque Anti-Mage performance where, like, we're in trouble, we want to win a game, let's just pick Anti-Mage.
How convenient, Parker. We want to win a game, we pick Anti-Mage.
Yeah. It's going to happen at the right time, like, and in the right draft, though. It's not as simple as, like, you just go into a draft expecting to pick Anti-Mage. The conditions have to come together.
It's like the OG Meepo. They don't pick it every game. It's just when you forget, when you like don't have enough counters, yeah. They're like, gotcha.
Yep.
But how can you forget the OG Meepo, the OG Husker?
Because they play it so much.
Yeah, they play.
They'll play PL doesn't sound like a cheesy pick, and it's not, but they'll just. There's other stuff you sometimes
they
decide to
ban. They play everything. Like, that's the issue.
Yep.
But for Empire, can they actually play everything? Do they actually play PL? Do they play Blue?
No, they don't.
Do they play Husker? I don't think they play Husker.
They don't play Ember.
And they don't play Ember.
Who doesn't?
Empire.
Oh, they play AM, right? Although, I think one of the replay that just went through was one where they just killed three heroes with a Blink Dagger Echo Slam, and then they decided to push bottom tier 2 without Echo Slam, and then they just lost to Shadow Fiend for the second time or something.
Yep.
I thought that this game was also very much so in 4CL's control for a long time.
I agree.
And they threw away a couple of fights, and they just lost momentum. You lose momentum against AM, you just lose.
And it was a very classic Anti-Mage performance. Like, 4CL were ahead, they had the advantage, but every time they were grouped up or had an Aegis, Havost was always in the right place, split pushing, forcing TPs back, and causing problems. They never were able to. They didn't pick him off enough.
There was like one, or maybe one.
There was a time bottom where he died, but he manned up and fought and got like two.
No, there was another
him,
one. The one before that.
Yeah, yeah.
They got the glimpse off, but he had 2 points in spell shield.
Yes.
But they missed the totem. That was really close though. They almost
got
it.
Yeah, they hit that totem.
That was huge if they would have killed him, because they would have stalled the split pushing for 1 minute.
And when they kill him bottom, by then, it was like past the stage where you need to be catching the anti-mage. Like, it would have been helpful. Like, they were still in the game, but they'd lost their lead already there.
Would you say that execution could have been better, even towards the later end of the game where they had the items. You have Ag Static Storm, you have Silver Edge to remove spell shield. You have a Blink Hex on Nyquil. Like, that technically should be enough to get a kill on anti-mage whenever you want.
Their late game, I think, could have taken a late game. They were in the late game and I think looking okay. They just lost one fight and had no buyback on SF. Pycat went all in buying the butterfly, and then you do that and you choose to fight. That fight was what? Probably decided largely by the Rubick as well. Aloha Dance's Rubick made some really sick spell steals, so
he got Fissure plus Wall.
He had the wall from the previous fight,
and then he stole Fissure. Yeah.
And he got the wall on the SF, and they kept preventing Pycat getting the ultimate off. Like, first he was getting bashed by the Anti-Mage, then the Anti-Mage was dying, he got cold. That was a really good cold embrace on the AM that saved his life, and then they went to Curse the SF. So that was just the deciding fight right there.
Yeah, like the SF illusion is huge because you have the aura, the minus armor aura.
And it hits hard, so. I think up until that fight, before that fight, it was an even game, I think.
Sure. Well, I think AM was already big enough.
Maybe Empire favored just because Empire make better late game decisions.
I agree.
So I was looking
that.
At this like, oh, I think Empire are going to win because I expect them to be better in the late game.
You could even say Hovos made better decisions than 4CL, because all the mid and late game was up on Hovos, whether he makes the correct decisions to split push.
When you have an AM draft, I think the decision gets very easy to make. It's like,
it can be, but you can easily mess it up too.
Sure. Well, that was game three in the book. Sirius is now led 2-1 by Empire.
Yep.
I do believe this is the last game, because 4CL is one of those very emotional teams.
Yeah. It was weird, because I really feel during game two towards the side, I was like, man, 4CL are going to 3-0 this series. It had that feel to it. 4CL were winning game two. They kind of threw it, and if they'd taken that game two, it really felt like they would have. They had the drafting edge, and all of these games, 4CL's had an advantage. Game 2, they definitely should have won. This game, they had an advantage, but you're versing an anti-mage, anything can happen.
This game is a bit harder to say.
Yeah, this game, I don't feel like, 4CL should have won, but it was.
Yeah.
They were in the game.
They could have won if they executed better or Empire made more mistakes, but it feels like both teams have really good chances of winning this game. And 4CL just fall short because they executed poorly in certain fights, and in certain areas they needed a bigger advantage because they were up against anti-mage and they couldn't kill anti-mage in a key situation. I mean, it's not even, that one wasn't even a mistake, but maybe a bit of luck on Hobos as well. He ran towards the other side, the Shaker Blink too, so they missed the stun from the totem.
So what made the anti-mage pick possible? Was it the lack of overall stuns? Because they had, I felt, quite a bit of stuns. Was it lack
stuns,
of counter
not
push?
Enough damage minus armor, I guess.
And they didn't have the right heroes to pressure early game. That was the important part.
They had the Darkseer, but nothing, no partner for the Darkseer. Yeah. They didn't have Nightstalker, they didn't have...
Well, they had the last pick. They could have picked Spearbreaker.
They commit Earthshaker.
They could have picked Spearbreaker, but their drop would be really...
No, Spearbreaker was banned, I'm pretty sure.
Because they had, at the last phase, they had Darkseer, they had Dazzle.
They had Earthshaker.
They had SF, so... If you were to pick SB, you needed a hero that would do more physical damage. And
it did a hell lot more than Disruptor.
Yeah, we were like feeling maybe it would be a Sada, but I think Sada might have been banned. Like, Sada would have fit better, it would have fitted the Earthshaker role, but it would have made the whole team deal more physical damage with the amp. So I think Sada, maybe something stronger, would have done more against the AM, but we could see the idea why they went for the Earthshaker. I think Earthshaker would have been better.
They already had picked the Earthshaker in the second stage. Wasn't the last pick Disruptor? This Disruptor
was
actually...
We're going to a break, guys. Break.
I want to talk about the game.
Well, they're going to break. Break.
No break.
No break?
No